Welcome everyone to the second event of the spring series of talks organized by Functional Fest. So let me start with a brief presentation on who we are. We are a group of Italian developers in love with functional programming. And all of this started because we wanted to organize a conference to gather all the different souls and communities which gravitate around functional programming in Italy and why not also abroad. So initially we decided to organize a conference, but when we saw that that was not feasible anymore, we decided to organize a series of online events instead. So we started last fall with four events. You can find the videos in our YouTube channel. And we have also some other events planned for this spring season. So on the 27th of April, we will have Nicola Rinaudot, who will speak about property-based testing. And on the 20th of May, we will have Feline Hermans, who will speak about the cognitive aspects of programming. And if you want to know more about what we do, or you just want to be reminded of next events, remember to keep in touch with us. We are Functional Fest on Twitter. You can subscribe to our YouTube channel, and you can check out our website, www.functionalfest.it. And before I forget, I'd like to thank DoubleLoop for their technical support and the infrastructure they provide for running these events. And let me jump right to our speaker, who is here. I'm very glad to host tonight Veronika Romashkina, who is an active open source software member. She's a maintainer, a mentor, a content maker, a co-creator of the open source organization Kovinik. And well, and this evening she'll be presenting her talk about totality, which is one of the key ideas which make functional programming really great. And before leaving the stage to her, I'd like to remind everyone that if you have any question, please post them on the YouTube chat, and it will be our duty to relate the questions to Veronika. So Veronika, I'm really glad to welcome you. So the stage is yours. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much, Marco. I will share the screen now. Okay. I hope you can see slides now. Cool. So hello everyone, and thank you so much for joining me today. And thanks Functional Fest for having me with you. We will talk about totality. It's a very interesting and very important concept of functional programming language. Yes, my name is Veronika. And we will discuss the definition of totality. What does it mean? We will see a lot of example of totality today. And also we'll try to understand why this concept is important and how you can use that. I will show some example of code, and it will be in Haskell functional language, but the concept is itself is applicable to all functional languages. So I hope that these examples will be understandable and you will be able to use them in your preference languages. So let's start. A few words about myself. As Marco mentioned, I am a Haskell enthusiast and I have more than 4 years experience working as a Haskell developer. I usually do backend stuff, and I already been in fun Haskell companies in very different areas such as healthcare, finance, insurance, and much more. And also I do a lot of open source work in Kovinik, the organization my friends Dmitry and I created a few years ago. There we maintain, develop a lot of open source libraries. Some of them are actually used in production. Besides that, we do a lot of tutorial stuff, blogging. We create different guides as well. and in general provide mentorship for people who are coming to functional programming, as our goal to make functional programming more approachable. Some of the big projects I was involved in is Google Summer of Code, was where I was mentor, and Kavanik is also participating in Hacktoberfest each year, helping people to get into Haskell, into functional programming through the GitHub and through this event. And last year, we actually created a course called Learn for Haskell, which is oriented on absolute newcomers to functional programming. Okay, that's about me. And now about Totality. In functional programming, the main object everything is working around is function. And a total function is the function which defined for all inputs of the corresponding input type. Or you can say in other words that the function is total when it provides some reasonable output on each value that it takes as an argument. So it's basic definition. And let's look at example of such total function. Here we have a function which takes some int and gives us the bool as the result. The question it answers each time is whether the given int is zero or not. And as you can understand, it will always provide some reasonable output, such as if it's true or if it's false. Here's a few examples on how it works on different inputs, but it definitely will work with every int. This is a guarantee given us by Totality. But unfortunately, not all functions here are total. The opposite to Totality concept is partiality, and functions that are not total are called partial. The famous example of a partial function could be the division, integral numeric division. So it actually, from its type signature, you don't see anything special about that. You can see that it works with integral and it also returns the integral. And actually, in most cases, it will work just fine. However, what would happen if we decide to divide by zero? It's a nice question. In this case, it will just fail in runtime. And let's see how the implementation for these function look like for int type. Here you see that there are a few cases. And actually, there is more than one way this function could fail. It could be the division by zero, which we already mentioned before, but also it could create the overflow exception when you try to divide a minimal bound of ints to minus one. In all other cases, it will work just fine. But in these specific cases, it will provide runtime exceptions. Now let's talk about math. I know math is complicated topic, but Totality actually originated in math and it came to functional programming through math. So let's see how similar these concepts are and what this analogy could give us in understanding more. So to recap, in functional programming, we do have function. Here it represented as some box and it gets a result. And if it could provide the output each time, it's a total function. If something goes wrong and the box blows, then the function is partial one. let's look at the definition in mathematics. It's actually quite similar to what we described before. The most standard illustration of totality and partiality in math is on this picture. We have a set of some elements, or which is input, and we have another set B, which is output. And the function is total if for each element, each dot in A set, we have the arrow, which actually represents the function that goes to the some particular element in B set. And the function is partial, not total, if there is at least one such element in A set, which doesn't have any arrow going from that to B set. So this, you see, are very similar if you think about A as input type and B as output type. And here the arrow is our function in programming way of thinking. However, they are a bit different in understanding what function actually is. In programming and in math, we mean different things by function. Here is a list of things which function in programming could do. First, it could hang. It could work infinitely without providing any reasonable output. Also, it can throw exception. And it can actually terminate also without giving any result due to the memory overflow. And of course, in functional programming, we do have side effects, which is things like reading from file or writing from file. This also defines functions in programming. And from now on, I would like to have a bit of agreement that by total functional programming, we mean total function plus the successful termination of functions. This is usually what we mean nowadays when we are talking about total functional programming. Okay, now we have a bit of understanding of what totality is and how total function look like. Now I want to talk about the most common cases where you can look for partiality and the ways you can fight with that, and actually why you actually need to fight with partiality. First, I want to discuss purity. Well, functional programming is very famous for being pure, and this is a really nice concept. And there are some people talking that pure function are safe function. Do you think that it's a correct statement? Are all pure functions are safe? Well, actually, not all functions are safe. This is the myth. At least some of the pure function could be not total, and this could lead to unsafety. And this could be example. How do you think? Is this function total or not total? You can write your answer in the chat and we will discuss that. Okay, as you see from the type signature, nothing again tells us that there is something unsafe with this function. And also when we look at the body of the function, it looks quite okay. for me. It has different types of comparison. And it seems like it covers all the cases in here. But is it true? We see that type signature tells us that the function works with any type of instance ord, or the type that could be compared to each other. And if we think about ints, then yeah, all these cases cover all the possible combination of comparison. But let's take double. You can compare doubles as well. And the difference is that double have a special element, none. And the comparison with none always returns false to you. So in all these checks in condition, we would get false. So none of this option is right to us. So the function that wouldn't know what to do, and it just will fail. So no, this function is not total as well. And I would add more that pattern matching is quite popular place where the partiality to can come into. Pattern matching is very powerful feature of functional programming, and it actually has a lot of modification and different views. It could be just simple embedded pattern matching in function declaration, but it also can use some construction like case of, which also allows you to do pattern matching in the function body. On the previous slide, the previous function was using guards. It's the checks of some condition, which will return true or false, and you can match on that. You can also pattern match in the lambda function and in the let or where constructions, which are create some local environments inside your functions. And of course, you can also pattern match in binding. It's working in, for example, IO monad, and you want to put some monadic value in some variable. You can use the arrow to bind the element. Here are some examples of how you can introduce partiality. For example, first function do that with the lambda pattern matching. You see here that it tells that each list that this function, lambda function, will take should have the first element in there, in the list. But actually, there are no guarantees at all that it is the case. As you see, it takes a normal list in there. So normal list could be empty as well. And in that case, this pattern matching will just fail. Another case, we assume that in our app or in our map, we have some particular key that we are looking for. And we are so sure that we bind that into the value, my val here, and unwrap it from the just constructor, probably for because we need to use that later on. But actually, there are no guarantees that the lookup will definitely return you some value. And another thing is the IO monad that I mentioned before. So here we're thinking that the user will provide us just one argument, and we simulate this in this binding, telling that we will get the list with just one element in that. But actually, getArg function also doesn't give us that guarantees. User can output can input any numbers of arguments, or they just can skip arguments. And in that case, we also will fail in here. So on this picture, you also see that pattern matching could be just on the high level of function declaration. But to summarize all that cases, I wanted to show how easy it is to introduce partiality with pattern matching, and actually not even compiler in some cases won't be able to help you with that. Yes, compiler has, especially in Haskell, it has very useful options that you can provide to it. So it could warn you on, for example, non-exhaustive pattern matching, but you need first to know about that options and you need to know how to use it. It doesn't work out of box. Partiality can be introduced not only in function, but when you are defining your value of some type. For example, this record type represents a user, and with a new user function, we introduce the user that has a name, but we don't provide a user age in here. So user age is actually the function from user to int. So it could take new user as an argument. By type, it's quite correct, but it don't have any information about user age inside. So this will just fail. In Haskell, such a thing is possible due to the laziness. So we can introduce the fields lazily. And it could be sometimes very helpful, but also keep in mind that it creates partial functions. Another thing is the sum with records, where you have a few constructors for your data type, and some of them have named fields inside. What happens here is JHC, the Haskell compiler, actually creates you the getter function for your constructor. Both street and country here are functions that take address data type and return you the text. So what happens when you apply this function to no address? Technically, it's correct. The types are right. However, no address don't have neither street nor country. And in runtime, it just will fail. That's why providing some records is anti-pattern, and it should be avoided. Also, it's very common and very easy to introduce accidentally some loops into your program with, for example, this recursive let introduction. And in this case, actually, you probably will just notice it when you will be just out of memory, because here it will accumulate all this action in the memory until it will just crash, because it could do that infinitely. But not all of the partiality is only introduced by a manual function or custom function. Actually, there are very famous and very widely usable function in the base library, which is the standard library of Haskell, that could produce runtime errors. Here you see a set of functions that work with lists, and they expect lists to be non-empty, but by type, they don't have this information, and they actually can fail because they just can't return anything reasonable in there. Here are some examples of how you can bump into these partial exceptions. First one is just from some functions that have some error function. Here you see that it's arithmetic underflow, but actually it contains nothing more, no more information about where it came from. You just know the underlying function that is responsible for that, but it doesn't helps you a lot with finding the bug with that. Another one is impossible compilers issues. So you can get it due some panics in compiler. Also segmentation faults, or even some errors that are very that could only happen on specific operation systems. Okay, we saw a lot of issues we could see with totality, and I hope that you now have a bit of understanding of what totality and why totality is important. And let's summarize that in benefit list that we have with that. First one is the code correctness. This is very important. You can create a lot of tests to cover your code base, and types also help you a lot. But it's much better to have the correctness by implementation, not by testing that. It will give you more opportunity to be sure in your logic and work on other aspects. Also, it will save a ton of time on debugging runtime exceptions. As you've seen, it could be really troublesome to get to the root of the problem when you are dealing with runtime exceptions. Total function, composed with total function, will also give you a total function. And this is very convenient for creating composable and modular code bases and architectures. And that will actually lead to more maintainable code. And with all that benefits, you can feel more confident reasoning about your code, about some performance, and about the issues that could happen with your code base. Okay, now I would love to speak about how to make functions total, but first I need to discuss something that I call fake totality. This is the problem when you actually, yes, you introduce totality, but it actually didn't worth it in the first place because it could lead in much larger problem. I will explain what I mean on examples. The first such example is wildcards. So when we see that compilers tells us about non-exhaustive pattern matching, the first thing we do, well, actually I would do, is to put the wildcard and say, whatever comes in there, you can match on this one and run some action. But it's quite tricky and it could create a whole layer of issues that you will need to investigate. For example, here we have a data type status which has at the moment approved and rejected options, and we have a function that based on the status will run some action for us. We wrote approved and it should run some approved action. And here we put the wildcard, which will run rejected action. Okay, the time goes and we probably need to add another status, for example, canceled. And when you add that, actually your code will compile just fine. Nobody will tell you that something is wrong or something missing or something needs to be changed, because the wildcard now covers both rejected and canceled status. And as you see, what it will do, it will run rejected action. But yeah, but it could lead to various issues, both on database side or with user experience. So it's very tricky to keep this all of these things in mind, especially when you have a very large code base. This is just a small example. So what I wanted to highlight is that writing the particular patterns is much better for maintenance. However, I do understand that it could be a lot of boilerplate where you need some special treatment of just one pattern and other should do the other just one action. There could be helpful to have some OR pattern matching. But unfortunately, in Haskell, it's not yet implemented, so we need to deal with lots of boilerplate at this point. Promises. We all maybe sometimes do think when we say that I know exactly that there is no way some function will return this particular input. The example here is function that should operate with the list of the same length. And we know that there will be the same length, but even compiler is not that sure here, and it will tell us about unexhaustive pattern matching. That's why we are putting the last case in here, which just error, impossible happened or something like this. The reason we do that is because we probably do some checks before running this function, before calling this function. And we are sure that it could never happen, but sometimes it happens. The code changed and other people started working on the project who don't know that guarantees you put on the particular function. It's quite easy to miss some cases in there. Another example of fake totality is naming. You can give the name of non-negative to just integer. And when you look at this create array function, it looks actually pretty safe. I feel safe about this function as it says that it takes non-negative. But in reality, it actually gives us nothing. It could take even negative numbers. And in that case, we won't be able to create an array. And sometimes the naming technique is used on some just internal functions or something like that, but it doesn't quite do what it says it does. So we need to be careful about that as well. As I mentioned before, partial functions exist in other libraries as well, and you need to be a bit careful about using them. Here we are writing functions that uses only standard base functions like max and maximum. But they are pure, yes, but actually one of these functions is not total, and we can get the exceptions like this, like empty list on the way. The point I want to make is not about not using any other dependencies or base libraries. The point is that we need to be aware about such pure functions that could lead to runtime exception. And if you're a library maintainer, it's quite important to put that at least in your documentation for the particular function, what errors it can produce. And ideally, it would be really nice if you could provide the total total option of the same function as well. And there are a bunch of ways how to do that. What could help us to do that possibly? Let's start with the first option. It's maybe data type. So instead of outputting some value A, we say that we will give you the result as maybe A, which means that this function will probably give you result, but if it couldn't do that, it just return nothing, but will not fail in runtime. Either is a similar to maybe approach. It works on the output type, but it provides more context about what went wrong. There is also the validation data type, which very similar to either, but however, it accumulates all the possible things, errors on its way. On the different side, you can think about how to deal with the input types. There, in previous one, we changed output types to be more safe. But here we actually can change the input type. For example, to only take non-empty structures when you need to work with non-empty elements. And more general one is the expressive types. So it applies both to input and output type. You can create flexible data types that will be shaped just the way that you need them. And actually, this technique is called make illegal states unrepresentable. We can think about the compiler as also fighter for totality. As I mentioned, there are a bunch of very useful warnings and options it could provide. But yes, it needs to be configured manually, and you need to know what the compiler is capable of in order to achieve this help from it. Another is static analyzer tool. This is a program application that runs on your code base and shows the vulnerabilities and weak spots. In Haskell, there is a STAN static analyzer, which actually could find out what partial functions you are using and even can get you information if you are using this wildcard sign-in pattern matching. Another useful tool is Program Verifier. Liquid Haskell is such tool for Haskell. And the way it works is that you can annotate your function declaration with some things. And when you run the tool, this annotation will be checked against your code, and you will be notified if something is not right in there. Okay, now we finish with the one part of the presentation where we were discussing the current totality representations, functions, and ways to deal with that. Now it will go a bit more advanced, but yet interesting topic about the internals of totality, about designing a total functional programming language. Let's get to this part. First, I want to mention that most of these parts, this section, is based on the paper by Turner that's called Total Functional Programming. I want to say that I'm not expert on the topic, but I will try to demonstrate you some interesting facts about totality and about the design around that, and explain some things more clearer. Okay, first I want to ask you if you think that Haskell is total language or not total. You can write your option in the chat on YouTube. Okay. Are we getting some input? Okay, I hope you had time to think about that. And the answer to this question is actually no. Haskell is not total language in the real total understanding. We already saw how easy it is to introduce partial function in Haskell. And this is due to the fact that Haskell is not by default total language. Okay, the next question for you would be, do you think that languages with dependent types are total? And do you think that it will help Haskell when we will get dependent types? What are your thoughts? I know many of you are waiting this feature, and this question is quite tricky. Don't be shy to just share your opinion. It doesn't matter. You just feel this way, just write it down. Okay, cool. And the answer to this question is not really. Here is the proof. There is a programming language, Idris, which has dependent types, but it's also not total by default. So dependent types are could help with some layer of totality and safety. However, it doesn't guarantee you that the language becomes total. In Idris, actually, there is a keyword total that you can put before the function declaration to state that the function you will write it will be total, and compiler will help you with that further. But as well, in Idris, there is a believe me function, which is used in some proof of theorems, and it's actually very similar to what in Haskell is called undefined, which actually leads to some of the runtime exception as well. Okay, now we talked about the current situation with total functional languages. Let's get the idea of the real one. We call that strong total functional programming language, and I will explain why that later. First of all, let's create a list of things that should be in the language that we will be designing. It of course shouldn't have any runtime errors. And because of that, everything should terminate. We still want the language to be pure. And due to how totality composes, all primitive operations should be total, so we can build up our code based on that. Also, all the pattern matching you do should be exhaustive. And there shouldn't exist any contravariant recursive types. These are the types that are represented by some constructor function that takes the function itself as the argument. So it becomes a recursive type. All recursions should be structural. That means that they should run on the sub elements of the input arguments of the recursion. And also there should be no unrestricted recursion. This is the recursion that helps to create infinite structure. Okay, this is our wish list. So let's think about why our current languages can't have all of these features. First of all, functional programming has extra element for each type, which is called bottom. Bottom denotes non-termination and runtime exceptions. So the bottom in its definition can get rid of some of the points from our checklist. So it's not possible to work with that and totality. Moreover, bottom also very related to the concept of lazy and strict by default languages. First of all, because of that, we are forced to think about how we want our language to behave. Should it be lazy by default or should it be strict by default? And moreover, even very similar lazy by default languages could have very different behavior in some situations for due to the liftness and unliftness terms that exist in the language. For example, if we have the bottom for type A and we have the bottom for type B, bottom will have their product, and probably it will have a few bottoms. And here we have two lazy by default languages. It's Miranda and Haskell. And in these two cases, it will behave quite differently. For example, if in Miranda you apply FST function to a bottom element as pair, it won't fail. It won't evaluate it immediately, while in Haskell, if you provide it with bottom, it will need to evaluate the structure and yeah, it will fail as it's a bottom. So what's wrong with bottom? Let's summarize that. So function is a strict and language is strict by default if the following rule applies to any function in there. If function f applied to bottom is equal to bottom, the language is strict, and in other cases it's lazy. So what we can think that if we get rid of bottom, we not only get rid of the denotation of termination, but we also will not have this split between strict and lazy language, as in total programming evaluation, the order will not matter anymore. So this is a really nice benefit. And here we come to the strong functional programming. This is the name that was inspired by a strong Church-Rosser property. And this is how we call total functional programming. And all existing, conventional functional programming is actually weak functional programming. Let's look at the property. Property states that every reduction sequence, it leads to a normal form, and normal forms are unique. This is a very nice thing because it means that we can evaluate our expression in any order as they will lead to one normal form. This will benefit us in optimizations, for example, and in performance. So this is really cool statement. Okay, but you need to keep in mind if you think about such language. First of all, it won't be Turing complete. And the second, it will terminate. And with the first thing comes the question, if all programs terminate, how could we write something like web backend or a REPL? Is it possible? This is a good question, but actually there is a workaround for this second statement for termination. Let's look at that. So now we need the concept of data and codata. If we will separate the set of input types and the set of output types, we can actually overcome this issue with determination. What it will mean? Usually the input set types is called data and output type set is called codata. Data is finite by definition as it's a total language. However, output data could be infinite. So we will be able to create these non-terminal actions. And the thing is that they should be separate and we cannot mix them up. So we will have the recursion specifically dealing with data and some magical built-in function to iterate on core data, and they couldn't use each other and produce other thing rather than what they take. So it's in theory, everything sounds quite interesting and cool, but is there actually useful total functional programming languages in there? And the answer is yes, there is DAL, very famous one. It's a pure total configuration language. Yes, DAL is not Turing complete, but for configuration language, this is not that important. It actually doesn't matter. Besides, it can actually give a few more benefits to the language, such as more guarantees on safety and also quite powerful tools. And I want to highlight that DAL language is used not only in functional programming community, it's already used everywhere and it's very widespread. So yeah, you can write very useful things with these total structures. Okay, here we came to the finish line. Thank you so much for listening to me. I hope now you can understand totality better and you will be able to notice these patterns of partiality in code you're dealing with, and you can get a few takeaways from this talk. Here is a list of resources that I've been using while preparing to the presentation. You can also check them out. And this presentation is actually based on the blog post we wrote in Kavajnik. So you can also see that and read that. Thank you so much for listening to me. And thanks again, Functional Fest, for inviting me. And also I want to say special thanks to Dmitry Kavajnik, who helped me with the presentation. And yeah, thank you very much. Here are my contacts. You can write me anytime. Thank you.
Thanks, Veronica, for the very nice talk. Okay, so we actually have a few questions from the audience, and I will start reading them to you. So the first question is: you actually showed us that partial functions are everywhere, even in the Haskell prelude. So is it possible to at least formally prove that function is total without using brute force?
That's a very nice question. Totality is quite a complicated concept, and one of the reasons why is because currently there are no great ways on proving that function is total, and it's quite another dimension on how you can do that. But yes, there is a few ways you can use in order to get the idea if your function is total or not. First one is to use some external tools like Liquid Haskell, which could help you is that it actually you can specify, for example, on the function that should take the list of same size, you can specify that through annotation in Liquid Haskell, and it will be checked for you. So yeah, it's quite tricky to search for totality and to prove that, but you can do that. And regarding the prelude and built-in partial functions, there are a lot of discussion around that and a lot of ways how to improve the situation in there. Currently, many people are moving to some alternative preludes, which is basically similar to the prelude, but it can have some functions similar to partial function, which actually are total. But it comes with a lot of trade-offs, because as you've seen, there are a bunch of ways how to make this partial function total. And there is no agreement on some blessed way you can do that. And we still need to at least be aware that it exists and it could affect any code as well.
Okay, nice. And I also have a question related to the, your actual answer. And my question is, which compiler features do you think are necessary to, like the very minimum to at least, to ensure that we minimize partiality of functions?
Yeah, excellent question. I guess there are a lot to think about. First I want to mention that probably at this point it won't be possible to make the language total, strong total language. But what we can do is to reduce some layers of the errors we can get from partiality, which is, for example, even dependent types could give us some guarantees on the type level, on compile time for different situation. For example, the similar to Liquid Haskell through dependent types, you will be able to reason about the length of the structures on the type level and things like that. But besides that, I'm not sure that I'm aware of any current proposals that could affect exactly totality issues. More possible is to create the tooling around that, like to adopt our static analyzing tools to have more check or do much more stuff. And this actually is very connected with the compiler as well. For now, the compiler started to create some IE files, which are very useful structural information about your models you have. And with that information, you can actually reason about how the code works. And based on that, you can give some hints to user with some suggestions. What compiler can help with is to improve these files and improve the structures for developers who are working on such tools. And for example, there are quite annoying things that are not represented in the structural AST in IE files at the moment, like recursive, there is no the difference between some structure construction. We actually have the same meaning, but it very important for us to have information on how user wrote that stuff, so we can give a better improvements and probably some code shortcuts and stuff like that. Yeah, this would be nice to work on. Also, there is the issue that I mentioned in the presentation when you can accidentally create loops. Actually, for that, there is some proposal to have another kind of LED construction, well, where you need to specify a special keyword rec, which will indicate that the following function could be recursive. So you won't be able to unintentionally introduce that. You will be able to use that only when you need it. And it will be quite helpful to have as well.
Okay, thanks for the answer. I have many more questions actually, but let's pose some questions from the audience. For instance, regarding loops and non-termination, a couple of questions are, I try to restate this question. Are exceptions due to out of memory allowed in the definition of totality, or are they like excluded as well? And also about non-termination, we have, with non-termination, you also exclude the infinite lists.
Okay. Yeah, very interesting question. The definition in totality is not actually stable or written somewhere in the frame and everyone using that definition. Sometimes people talking about totality could only mean the totality in mathematic understanding of that. And there we don't have any notion of termination. It's only applicable to the programming. And in programming, there are lots of different thoughts around that. As I mentioned, most of the people agree that by total, we mean the programming with total function and with termination. And the case with the memory leaks is also quite used to this definition of termination. We need the successful termination, and here we won't have successful termination. And yeah, I agree that this could be by definition of totality. Sorry, and could you please repeat the second question you mentioned?
Sure. Whether infinite lists are also excluded by the definition of totality, your definition of totality.
Yeah, infinite lists are very tricky structures, and it actually could work only in lazy languages, or where you specify that the structure is lazy. When you work with a laziness in Haskell, usually you use that for good, and you actually get a lot of benefits from infinite structure, because you just operate with the normal structure, but you let that to have infinite meaning, and that opens some more doors. But ideally, in totality, there should not be such infinite languages, because the language won't be lazy by default. And for that, we could have some output data that could be infinite. For example, in Idris, it actually already exists that whole data that I was talking about, you can define infinite structure in there through core data. It's very tricky because usually you don't always work like clearly with infinite structure. You just stream over that all the time to get the results. Hope this answer the question.
Okay. I think you did. So we have one last question from the audience by Greg, which is actually you mentioned that in total programming languages, all primitive operations must be total. And does it mean that we can't have integral divisions in there?
Nice question, very interesting one. It shouldn't mean that because we can provide other ways to somehow define this function to be total. There are actually a few options how to do that. First, we can, for example, agree on some default which should be returned when you have the division by zero, for example. It could be zero, but yeah, I understand that not all the people can agree with that. But this is not the only option. For example, you can have it checked on the compile time on type level. So the program that will have to divide by zero won't compile. So we will have compile error instead of runtime error. So yeah, we can have a few options there how to create language.
Okay, so in this case, you would rely on dependent types, for instance, or refined types. Yeah. Okay, nice. So I see there are no more questions from the audience. I think we can thank our speaker, Veronica, for her very nice talk. Once again, I'd like to thank our technical sponsor, Double Loop, for taking care of the streaming infrastructure. And if anyone has any questions about Veronica's talk, can actually drop us a message either in the YouTube chat or at our in our website, or contact us directly or Twitter us. So I will remind you our Twitter handle, which is FunctionalFest, and our website www.functionalfest.com. So thanks again, Veronica, and see you next time.
Thank you so much. Thank you. See you.